So we have completed the course for the midterm examination yesterday. Today we venture on to the course relating to the topics after the midterm examination. So what you go through today will be in the syllabus for the comprehensive examination. Let us proceed. The subject is patents. I would like to repeat once again, because there are some people who have not yet accessed Takshila. So for their benefit, let's share my desktop and go through the procedure. When you type elearn.bit-pilani.ac.in, you get this login, you give your user ID and password, and you get a page like this. Online lecture schedules are available here. Go here. 653 is scheduled for today. It was scheduled for yesterday as well. So this is where you come to know whether you have a class or not. Having done this, you can go to My Courses and take a look at the courses in which you are registered, and you have this course over here. When you get to the course page, go to announcements, and there's just one announcement so far. There'll be another one tomorrow morning. This gives you the planned schedule. Buffers are the cushions I'm keeping just in case we need to take some extra classes. We need to take 11 classes for this course as per schedule. I plan to take 12 in any case. That's intend to take one extra class in any case. And this is the schedule as of now. This is the master schedule provided to us by the instruction division as to which are the days we should normally schedule our classes. They've given us 18 slots in which we have to take 11 classes. And this column gives you, now when I've cut out midterm, it means that our midterm is over here. We have our midterm exam on the 29th in the forenoon. Now, having said this, we go back to the course page, and on the course page, you have a quiz which will be activated from September 10 to 20th and will have a 5% weightage. There is an assignment running concurrently to this, and the assignment is please complete all the lab exercises, and that does not carry any marks. There was a question. So is that in the course for the midterm exam? Yes, because everything we do in this course is to be evaluated in the examination. So anything we do in the course is in the course for the examination. It's another matter that one really doesn't require a very big depth to be able to proceed with the exams. Now, in this course, we have given the dates on which these classes actually took place, and we have given the topic under each. And that the tentative schedule has also been indicated here. So we complete the midterm syllabus completed over here. On the 9th, we move on to Module 6, Layered Brokers, MVC, Service Oriented. Again, continue with Module 6, few more topics. And then on the 26th, please note that next week our class is on Sunday, not on Saturday. Thereafter, on 22nd Saturday, we will review the midterm syllabus. So by then, whatever you have given me on the chat site or any questions I've noticed, I'll take a look at the pages on Takshila also where the discussions are there. And whatever I feel needs to be covered will be covered on 22nd, and then on the 29th forenoon you have this examination. Thereafter, we are supposed to complete this last topic in one session, but I've put it into two different sessions. We'll do a little bit of review also for the comprehensive examination. So this gives you an idea of how the course moves. There are people having problem getting a course handout, click here, it gets downloaded. If it's not getting downloaded, try in a different browser, try on a different machine, check it out, it has to work. There are some old question papers given here, and it's not my job to solve them for you. So with that, let's go back to the course. Okay. Just trying to catch up as to whether there was anything put down in the chat, because normally people have doubts on the course conduct. Now, we want to patterns. And here, besides the courseware, I have given certain supplementary slides for you to look through. It is important that you go through the book, because what we cover in the contact sessions is somewhat limited. You need to understand these patterns quite thoroughly. Not very thoroughly, but quite thoroughly. You should at least understand what these patterns are about. A major component of this course relates to, in the midterm exam, tactics. Write scenarios, and you achieve the scenarios through tactics. Over there, you've got the task that an architect would recommend. The project manager will have it executed. The activities that have to be conducted to maintain certain quality parameters. And then, a major part of the course has to do with patterns. Pattern is a form of recurring behavior which you can emulate to solve your problems. And there are various catalogs available for patterns. This is the catalog which okay. There is a request that some scenario should be drawn to demonstrate and to, because there's nothing called a tactic diagram. The diagram is basically a scenario. And the scenario is a quality attribute scenario. And to tackle it, you have a tactic. And for tactics, we don't have any diagrams here. Like you have a tactic called the ping echo tactic. We often use it in DOS just to find out whether our machine is getting across to various servers or not. So you ping the server, and the server echoes you the time it took to be accessed, whether it got accessed or you failed to access it. So you come to know that the server is alive. So this is a ping echo tactic. It is an availability tactic. So if you are given a situation where you need to verify whether the server exists or not, you're asked to recommend a tactic, you'll obviously say it's ping echo. And then if you have to explain what it is, well, you say that you send a ping, which is a message which a client sends to a server. So that's how you explain it. Now, how you draw a scenario, go to the textbook, go to each of the chapters on the quality attributes, and you will find the standard diagram drawn there, which has got a source of stimulus, it's got a stimulus, it's got an artifact, it's got an environment in which the artifact exists, there's a response, and there's a measurement of the response. So if you draw a diagram, I'll be showing you that diagram only during the review session. You have to draw that standard diagram. Anytime there's a question like this, draw the diagram, label it. Now, when you label it, the label should be contextual. So if you've gone through, you'll find that the general scenario is given, where anything can plug in, and then they've given you specific scenarios for each quality attribute. Now, these tactics are basically fine-tuning techniques. You have an application, maybe you've already developed it, you can add a tactic to it. It's like the polishing up after the job has been done. But the big picture is made up of patterns. You have the, you may have an architectural strategy, you can have an architectural model, but these things are made out of patterns. Now let us try to understand the context of a pattern. Does it mean that if you know all the tactics and you know the patterns, you will make a good architect? It's something like this. If you know your do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, or in Hindi, sa, re, ga, ma, pa, da, ni, sa, will you make a great musician? I don't think I need to answer this question for you. Then you tell me, I already know sa, re, ga, ma, pa, da, ni, sa, I can sing it out in the correct tune. Now do I become a good musician? Again, you know the answer. You've got to be able to apply these notes. Similarly, you've got to apply these notes. And then how well should I be know the patterns? Should I only study applications or do I need to understand the patterns properly? Again, my same question. Do you need to know sa re ga ma pa da ni sa more properly? Should I do a lot of what the musicians say, riyaz, or a lot of practice on that? Or should I just try applications? The answer is the same. You've got to understand your patterns very well. And then a good architect has got to keep repeating packets. These patterns then are the vocabulary. They are the grammar. In fact, the patterns would be closer to the rags. So it's not as if you just, the rag itself can make good music, but then the rag is not the song. It's the pattern on which you will make your music. It is a pattern. So you study all the patterns. So after you study do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, you've understood quality attributes. You've understood what quality attributes you need to use there. They are like the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. They are like the basic notes of music. Then these patterns are like the rags, the basic patterns on which you'll formulate your songs. And then architecture, yes, it's music. And you can become a Bach, you can become a Rahman, you can become a great architect if you've understood these patterns properly, you've understood the tactics properly, and then you keep your eyes and ears open, you find out a lot about architectures, even within your company. There's no dearth of architectures you can study. Go to Microsoft's site, Microsoft will tell you about the architecture. Go to Unix, you'll find the architecture, Linux architecture, how Linux is laid out, the various components and parts of Linux are laid out. You go to Android, you've got the Android architecture. You've got the iOS, you've got the iOS architecture. You've got the OSI model for networking, you've got an architecture there. You've got mail servers, you've got an architecture out there. You've got Oracle, the way the clients of Oracle access Oracle, you've got an architecture there. So there is no dearth of architectures to be studied. You do a website and you put up a business logic somewhere, you've got an architecture there. So architecture is all over the place, and there are various patterns which are applied in this architecture to get it clear. And for our convenience, we make a catalog where we say that there are some patterns which are basically module based, some are component connector based, some are allocation based. This is how Len Bass likes to look at it. There are other approaches to patterns also, which I've given you separately in supplementary notes. And you need to be aware that various approaches are possible. Some of the major patterns are being covered by us. And it's not as if we cover all patterns, you know. You cannot cover all patterns. How many patterns are there? Okay. There is an unlimited number of patterns. But we study the basic patterns, the patterns which have gone through history, and all other patterns can be in some way or the other perceived as though they have been derived from these patterns. So here in modules you have a layered pattern, component connector, you've got broker, model view controller, pipes and filters, client server, peer-to-peer, SOAP, publisher, subscriber, shared data. In allocation you've got MapReduce, multi-tier pattern. And then we, in this chapter, we talk about the relationship, using tactics together. So let us now understand basically what how we define a pattern. And if you have already moved beyond the midterm syllabus in object-oriented analysis and design, maybe you've touched patterns there also. So it's not as if those patterns are not important to an architect. An architect has got to know all the patterns that you cover under object-oriented analysis and design. All I'm committing to you is that I will avoid, I do not promise that there will be no question, because you know, if you have to make a presentation, you may choose to use one of the OAD patterns in your answer paper. That may not be the ideal fit, but maybe it is a fit. Maybe you'd like to, you feel that it is very important to show a package diagram. You think it's an architectural decision that you have taken and you want to present the package diagram. Package diagram is something you study in OAD, but I'm not going to try to duplicate it here. You might like to show an activity diagram. And the activity diagram, you are going to have the relationship between various components. So on the activity line, instead of showing a class, you decide to show a component. No, I'm going to accept it. So, you know, you cannot put knowledge into watertight compartments. While I've been talking about software architecture, I've correlated with music. Now, is music in the course? No, it's not. Absolutely not. I'm not going to ask you to write 5 rags in the examination. But OAD is basically a bifurcation of the same larger subject of software design. OAD concentrates on the micro level, software architecture goes at the macro level. So most of the patterns we relate here, and even the patterns which we use from OAD, we'll be viewing them at a macro level rather than at a micro level. Now, what is a pattern? Okay, pattern is a one solution fit all. Okay, yes, we've got all the patterns lying in a rack out there, and somebody comes to me and says, I've got a problem, I've got a stomachache. Oh, what did you eat last night? Last night, what did I eat? I think I ate some rotten potatoes. Okay, rotten potatoes is the context. Stomachache, here, take this tablet, eat it. That's a solution. So that's a pattern. So there's a recurring situation, there's a context. Oh, excellent. Somebody asked me, you must be a late joiner, my friend. You asked me whether what we are teaching right now is in the portion for the midterm exam. Sorry, this is not in the portion for the midterm exam. I hope I'm not disappointing, but we're moving on. So what we do this week and next week is not in the portion for the midterm exam. But then, as I was just telling you, we can't draw watertight compartments. While discussing patterns, I happened to mention some tactics. Tactics is in the quotient for the midterm exam. And now you tell me, sir, you said whatever you mentioned here is not in the course of the midterm exam. Sorry, sir, can't help it. After all, it's the same course. I'm just carrying on from there. So definitely what I teach today, the foundation has been laid in that part of the syllabus, and I might mention things there, and they might directly go and help you in the examination. Now, I can't help it. So to that extent, yes, relevance to midterm is there, but the way we define syllabus, no, patterns is not in the syllabus for the midterm examination. But what I teach today will obviously have correlations to what we have done in the past. I'm carrying the course forward. I guess it answers your question. No, my friend is not there to take the answer. Okay, let's move on. So now we come with an architectural solution. Okay, great. So thanks for the acknowledgement. So, you know, actually, a few messages coming here, I may not answer them directly. Sometimes I do. It makes it feel more like a classroom for you as well as for me. You get a feeling that, yes, there's somebody interacting with you. So interactions are most welcome. Some of them I may not field. Not a good fielder. And besides, my present job is batting. So you have a problem, but patterns try to solve a general problem. Like, okay, मक्खी नहीं मारना है, सब कीड़ा को मार दो. सॉरी फॉर द लैंग्वेज, आई डोंट वांट टू किल अ फ्लाई, आई विल गो एंड किल ऑल इंसेक्ट्स. सो इफ आई वांट टू किल एन इंसेक्ट, आई हैव गॉट अ स्टैंडर्ड सॉल्यूशन. ओह, यू हैव गॉट अ फ्लाई टू किल, फ्लाई हैपेंस टू बी एन इंसेक्ट, ओके, हियर इज माय सॉल्यूशन. इन व्हाट कॉन्टेक्स्ट? इट्स इन माय किचन, ओके, आई हैव गॉट टू मेक श्योर दैट इट डजंट डैमेज द फूड. सो द सॉल्यूशन आई गिव यू, आई हैव गॉट टू टेक मेक श्योर दैट द फूड इज नॉट डैमेज्ड. सो ओवर हियर आई हैव गॉट अ बिग रिपोजिटरी ऑफ solutions. So one very popular one in today's world is a model view controller. Anybody wants to create a website, he goes, looks up model view controller, it sets up a model, sets up a view, sets up a controller, the three major components. And then he says, yes, this seems to work. It gives me a lot of flexibility. It allows me to concentrate on my business logic separately. I can use a specialized database. Okay, model view controller. So model view controller is a pattern, so it becomes a solution. Model view controller has got interconnected items, it's got a topology, it's got a layout, it's got a semantic of its own. And this whole thing, I just bring it and plug it in as a solution to a problem. The problem was, wanted a website with a good performance, with a good getup, and I should have a flexibility to change the getup without interfering with the business logic or the way the database is stored. So fine. So context was development of a website. So this is what typically a pattern is about. Now we'll take a few examples of patterns. And a popular example of a pattern is the you have the OSI network layer architecture. So I've just opened it up on the internet for you. I'll give you a quick glimpse. People like to see examples, you know, they give us a lot of examples. We feel very happy about it. So these are layers. These are the host layers, these are the media layers. BITS is not Birla Institute of Technology and Science. I don't need to warn you. So physical. Physical is the wires, the last mile, the Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, GSM, CDMA. All these are the physical movement of the data is handled at this layer. People who are experts in this layer don't even go to school and try to study the remaining. They don't care what data link is. They don't care what network is, this, that, that. Okay, we'll make wires, we'll consider this layer, and you can pass your career just sitting in the physical layer. Many an electronics engineer might like to venture into this field, and they just build physical layers. Then, addressing the physical layer is handled by the data link layer. There's a company called D-Link. They concentrated very heavily on this layer initially. Now, they've expanded into other layers. There's something called the network layer, which determines the path. There's a company called Cisco, which has clubbed a few of these layers and made it their business. It's one of the world's largest IT companies. I'm sure we've got students who are over here who are from Cisco. We always have some. So, yeah, I was just looking whether somebody said, yes, sir, I am from Cisco, or I am from D-Link or something. Normally people come up with such responses. Maybe they don't need to attend this class. Then you've got a transport layer which establishes an end-to-end connection. We talk about reliability. You have the session. So as a host, you create a session. So you communicate within a session and you make a signature. And application, finally the application is running. Say your application could be the mailing application. Your application could be the user interface for Ola or Uber or Uber. Or you may have Book My Show, the application. So each layer is like an envelope. It takes what was done at the higher level, puts it in an envelope, passes it on to the next layer. Next layer does some more work on it, puts it into an envelope, sends it to the next layer. Yeah, somewhere in between, encrypting could also be done. So, and generally in any given technology, OSI is a generalized network layer. There are lots of specialized layers. There are companies which have combined 2-3 layers into one layer. So there are some people who say, no, I'll handle these first 3 layers all in within my application itself. I will directly like to talk to my transport layer. So I will interact with TCP/IP. Yeah. Now, data link does take care of protection, data encoding. Data link takes care of it. Yes. MAC translation will also handle that data link. Now, sometimes it could be handled as physical also. So a given company will have to make sure that if they're operating in one layer in a standard configuration, they have to follow the standard protocol for communication with the rest. And then when you develop a particular architecture as a layered architecture, there are certain constraints that are imposed. So generally, you just refer to them as layers A, B, C, and each one is a layer. Then you say, you have elements, you have relationships, you have constraints, and they have weaknesses. Now, you're adding a lot of procedures. Okay, I'll give you a very simple example, which is totally removed from IT, to give an example to illustrate to you what the layers, weakness of a layer. You have a company, and recently I was doing some interaction with these people, a company like Tata Motors, which had an organization with 7 layers at the factory. They decided to cut it down to some 3 or 4 layers. Now, why did they do it? Because they felt that having so many layers added a lot of overhead, a lot of communication, a lot of delay in action. So if you could cut it down into 4 layers, they call it lean mean management sometimes, there's management jargon. But what really it achieved was that less communication cost, okay, more activity had to be done in each layer, but with modernization and technology, that is possible. So with computers, you know, sometimes it becomes convenient to have a number of layers so that you can isolate the working between layers. But yet, remember that each layer interacts only with the next layer. So when you have a communication to go through, it becomes, now even your network protocols, there are variations available, and people work with the variations of these layers. OSI is a standard 7-layer model, but there are variations of this which are in actual use. And we are not here discussing computer networks, so we don't go into details. And even for the purpose of software architecture, you don't have to know the details of the OSI architecture. Those of you who wish to specialize in networks, we'll probably do a course which will have probably one module on each of the layers. So if there are 7 layers, there'll be 7 modules, and probably the first 3 modules will be the course for the midterm exam, the remaining 4 in the comprehensive exam, and you will know exactly what is done at each layer, how you do encoding from one layer to the other, how you add packets together, how you distribute packets, collect them together, which responsibility is executed by which layer, all that would be the thing. But what you need to understand as an architect is that yes, the responsibilities can be divided into layers. So we have a next. See, and that is the extent to which I intend to cover in class. And definitely, to be able to excel in examination, the level of knowledge required is a little more. But if you want to just get through, well, good enough. So that's why I said, hang the exams, because they're too easy to pass. I know that you're a busy professional, lots of work to do, but then this is going to be a bread and butter. It depends what you want to be. You want to be a Saidi musician playing music, or you want to be a Rahman one day. Yeah, layer unidirectional, okay, but very interesting when somebody said yeah, it's unidirectional. What about the OSI layer? The sender, it starts from the application, cut, downwards onto the physical layer. moves along the physical layer, and the cut, 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 it goes upwards. So where unidirectional? It's moved downward here, moves upward there. But the thing is, each layer interacts only with the next layer under standard layered pattern. But then your variations, if you study your book, they will tell you there are variations, there are exceptions. Sometimes an expert, and mind you, it should only be an expert fiddling around, he allows certain concessions to get some gains on a particular quality attribute. Now, is that the, does the architect have to get a license issued? No. License is success. You demonstrate. You do a POC, proof of concept. You do a spike, terminology from some process models. So you do it, you demonstrate that, well, this works and this is desirable. It gets followed. And there's nothing like having to follow rules by the book, but the rules are rules, and you have to have rules, otherwise you don't have anything to relate to. You have to have models. These models are the basis for your thought. So once you have a model, you can vary from the model. But when we educate, we study some basic models. Now let's try to go through the Broca pattern. Relaxed layer architecture. Somebody just mentioned to me relaxed layer. I'll refer you back to the book. Layer architecture, you relax certain rules of layered pattern. So, take it. Good. You have to justify why you are doing that. And there's a book, I'm not sure whether it's been recommended as a reference book or not in this course. No, it is not. It is not referred as a, I'll give you the name next time. Beautiful book on architectural patterns. I'm forgetting the name. Anyway, I'll mention the name. If you can easily get hold of the book, you can read through it. It's a book just on the basic patterns. And I've given supplementary slides here. You will notice here. That is, every slide I've given a supplementary slide. Session 2 supplementary. Here. I'll just quickly give you a glimpse of the supplementary slide. You should go through it, it gives you a lot of ideas which will help you to move forward. So, Eric Gamma, those are design patterns. I'm talking about architectural patterns. Yeah, the URLs are used in the case study. If you, even in an examination situation, I will try my best to avoid directly asking you to draw UML diagrams which are absolutely OAD specific, but that knowledge of UML will definitely come in handy in software architecture. Your software, in software architecture, we don't follow UML precisely as given by the object management group. But we do use URL, and design patterns are used by architects to present their knowledge. So it's absolutely, when you go into the practical working life, there's no watertight compartment between design and software architecture. But since you are doing these, most of you are doing these two courses simultaneously, I'm trying to stay off trying to cover those components. And I'm going to try to stay off evaluating your knowledge on those components very directly. But then, life is not all closed systems. Now, let's talk about a Broca pattern. Now, sometimes you have a system to be constructed out of number of services which are required by a large number of people. So, you can have, for example, flats which are available across Bangalore, and they are required by a large number of people. There are thousands of people who come and they want to occupy these flats, and these flats are available in multi-storied buildings or in areas. So what we do is we start looking for brokers. A broker is a person who knows where all these services are available. In our case, it's software services, could be a database service, could be a mail service, could be an SMS service, could be simply a computing service. And the broker knows where the service is available. So you get across to the broker. And the beauty is the broker in Bangalore speaks Hindi, whereas the landlords may not be knowing Hindi. So you, the broker can speak the language of the server as well as the users. The problem is that you want these services to be used by a large number of people and dynamically. The person just flies down to Bangalore and should be able to find a house for himself within 24 hours. Now, same here. You suddenly want to be able to access a ready-made database. You know that the database exists. Maybe you know the address. Maybe you don't know the address. Or maybe these are standard services which are available, provided by a number of people. So, and you may not like to learn the language or the exact protocol of communication used by the service. So what you do is, you can use the service. So number of clients, they'll use it from the service. And the queries will be routed via the broker. Well, it has its disadvantages. The broker can manipulate the data. The broker may be a source of leakage of information. You did not want to know anybody, to your neighbor, to know that your house is available. The broker shared the information. You know who's your neighbor. Your broker didn't know. So when the broker was approached by your neighbor looking for a house close by, he referred your house. So similarly, a broker is a vulnerability. It could be a security thing. It could be a load point, excessive load on a broker. A broker becomes very popular and everybody accesses that broker. So whereas if you had got across directly to the server, you might have got good access and good throughput. But just because you go through a broker, things have got. So a broker becomes not just another point of failure, as mentioned by one of my friends here. It becomes a single point of failure, which is a bigger problem. So when all your servers are working and all the clients are okay, one broker breaking down can cause a lot of problem. So there are the pros and cons. Every good solution has got its problems. Even eating too much of good food has its problem. So in addition to brokers, you may have proxies. Sometimes to get across to a broker, you may go through a proxy, which could be again because of language issue, because of buffering, because of solutions already available locally. You don't want to every time go and access it. So you can have client-side proxies. So then you have a concept of a bridge. If your broker may be accessing multiple networks which do not have a common feature, could be a different network topology, could be, okay, somebody says no audio, but there's only one person who said it, so chances are that it's a local problem. Because normally if there's an audio failure, I have at least 20 people saying no audio, no audio, no audio, so please, you have to, yeah. So, in fact, I've immediately got comments saying that they've got audio quality is good. So, okay. The difference between a proxy and a broker. A proxy is normally something, let's say one thing. Say you have a mail service. Your company has got a mail service hosted by your headquarters in California. In India, you've got 5 locations in 5 major cities. And each of these locations, you have a proxy. Proxy will do a number of things. Firstly, even if the main service is not available, the proxy will not let you know. Proxy will accept your queries and process them subsequently. Ease of access, so buffering. You will be able to handle buffering of the data. Then it might be able to collate data for sending to various places. So it does a lot of housekeeping. And then the broker puts you in touch with unknown people mostly, or different communication protocols, or different language. And if, again, the broker, if he's working over different backgrounds, then it uses a bridge. It could be different networks. Sometimes you may like to use a bridge even to isolate networks. So somebody is talking about, actually what happens, I can't blame you because at the other side you are studying design patterns. So somebody says adaptive design pattern. Knowledge of adaptive design pattern will definitely help you understand a broker. And here also, this to serve the example, these have been almost shown like classes. But in reality, this is just to illustrate the point, in reality, a broker could be a machine. So from an architect point of view, he's normally be looking at a larger unit as a broker. And adapter is normally one-to-one. There's a class here, there's a class here. You put an adapter between two classes to be able to, which so that you can communicate between the two classes. So people are saying that lots of issues get added when you put in these patterns, like security issues and things like that. Yes, issues are there. These problems are there. In fact, you have a headache and you take a medicine and then they tell you there are side effects. Now, what you'll bother about is whether you're bothered about the side effect or the cure. Well, there's somebody dying of cancer, you'll die in 6 months with medicines, you'll live for 10 years, and it has side effects. Yes, side effects. So the doctor and the patient and the family, they take a decision as to whether you're more concerned about the main effect or the side effect. And one of the biggest side effects of living is that you will die. So much for side effects. So if you're afraid of the side effect of living, you have to consider which is worth it, living or being afraid to die. So with all these solutions, every solution will add problems. No solution is without a problem. And well, we have to move on with it. Okay, so there are variations of broker solutions that are presented here. Client server, broker, client side proxy thing, what type of jobs these may do, marshalling, sending, unmarshalling of messages. Then weaknesses, layer of indirection. Indirection is something you studied in OAD. Indirection has its problems. Again, it's sometimes easier to understand things from an unrelated example. Soccer, football. Of late, there are lots of movies on hockey going around. Well, indirection is a good way to score a goal. So with software architecture, sometimes a direct approach does not solve a problem. So what is indirection? Object-oriented analysis and design grasp. First page of your textbook tells you about indirection. Indirection is when you use an intermediary component to communicate between component A and component B. This is called indirection. Indirection is an overhead, but it is a solution. It improves communication sometimes, gives you buffering, gives you some amount of translation. All sorts of benefits are there. So broker, it appears as if it's giving you complexity, single point of failure, and all sorts of issues may be there. Then, another example that I would like to give you in this category is Python filters. I don't smoke, but you know, if you see old Western movies, there'll be a pipe over there. And filter, a cigarette has got a filter on it. Filter cigarette. So you have pipes and you have filters. And take the plumbing setup as an example. You have a lot of pipes, and then in between they've got filters. What does a filter do to the material in the pipe? It removes some stuff. In our case, these filters can add some stuff also. They can change the nature of the liquid also. So basically, the most famous example of the pipe and filter is the Unix language. Many of you may already be aware of Unix. You In case of broker failure, what recovery and backup plan should be there? Okay, I think I'll keep this for a separate day. Very tight for time now, but definitely we can have new kind of routing, new kind of service discovery. You can have multiple brokers with a service discovery setup. If one broker fails, you can shift on to another. Service discovery has been discussed under the tactics for availability. Okay, so pipes and filters. There are a number of activities to be done, and for different situations, you need to do them in a different order. Sometimes you might like to work on them parallel, but you would like to be able to provide each of these facilities as a standalone unit so that you can just put them together in whichever form you feel like. And a typical example is the Unix language itself. The Unix language works with pipes and filters. So what you do is you take a command. Command takes the input from standard input, gives the output to standard output. But you can redirect any standard input or standard output . There is a question here, if there is a broker failure, recovery and backup. Normally what happens is you access a broker, and if the broker is not working, you find alternate routes. And broker is not a data store. And normally in any network communication, you have a handshaking protocol. So until you receive a confirmation of your handshake, you know that the data has not gone through. So you will attempt again. So I just thought I'll field the question by one of our participants here. Now, the problem is you want to provide a mechanism, you want to provide flexibility, you want to allow parallelism. How do you solve it? You write a whole lot of filters and you pipe them to each other the way you like. Those of you who are familiar with the Unix language and are working on it will find it absolutely no problem understanding what this is about. So there are questions coming up. I'll have to take them up a little later. Now, here you are. Your pipes connecting two blocks. Each block we call a filter. Each block does only one job. Then here is parallelism. You can have two pipes going out, one here, one here. Even Unix allows that. Unix allows you a T. Are there any of the participants here who are familiar with Unix or using Unix or Linux on the job? Yeah. Good number of you. Oh God, it's a long list. Great. So your people, I'm sure, appreciate pipes and filters. You live with pipes and filters, and this is typically a T connection in Unix, where you can send data off in two directions. Very famously used to create an error log, or just log data at a particular stage and move on with the remaining data to proceed to the next stage. So if you want to know an intermediary condition of data, you can pick it up from here. And the steps here could be sorting, removing certain data, filtering using commands like grep to get rid of certain information. So this is how you proceed from one filter to the next and the solution. So somebody used pipe and filter to construct the Unix language. It has elements of filters and pipes. You should be able to delineate. The job of a pipe is to convey data. Attachments are there. And the constraints are the outputs and inputs should be compatible to each other. Unix has taken great care of it so that any output can become an input. In fact, any standard input can be the output of some other command can be taken, but a little bit of care has to be taken by the person using the commands to make sure that he understands the flow of data. The data type compatibility has to be maintained in your pipes and filters. So this little bit of precaution needs to be taken. So with that, I have finished the part one. I'm going to, before I pause the lecture, I just want to show you the supplementary. This is for your self-reading. Here, the categorization, muds and structures, distributed, interactive and adaptable. This is a different catalog. And in this catalog, you have layered pipe filters, blackboard. Under distributed, you have broker, microkernel, pipes and filters. Under interactive, you have model view controller, presentation, abstraction control. PAC is a very popular pattern. Reflection pattern and microkernel pattern. So with this formation, a good bit of details have been given about layers patterns. I've given a lot of reading material here. You could please use these. This gives you some additional reading material. And blackboard is another very nice pattern which, so with that I will, we will okay. Pattern part two is what we will cover in the next session. Let's take a break of 5 to 10 minutes.